Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Infibeam Avenues Limited earnings conference call for Q3 FY 2021, hosted by KR Choksey Research. This conference call may contain forward-looking statements about the company, which are based on the beliefs, opinions, and expectations of the company as on date of this call. These statements are not the guarantees of future performance and involves risks and uncertainties that are difficult to predict. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Ms. Parvati Rai from KR Choksey. Thank you, and over to you.
Thank you, Sanford. Good evening, everyone. On behalf of KR Choksey Research, we welcome you all for the Q3 FY 2021 earnings conference call of Infibeam Avenues Limited. I take this opportunity to welcome the management of Infibeam Avenues, represented by Mr. Vishal Mehta, Managing Director, Mr. Vishwas Patel, Executive Director, Founder and CEO of Payments Business, Mr. R. Srikanth, President, and Mr. Hiren Padhya, Chief Financial Officer. We begin the call with a brief overview of the company by the management, followed by the Q&A. I now hand over the call to Mr. Vishal Mehta for his opening remarks. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thanks, Parvati, and thank you everyone for joining us on the call today. I hope all of you are safe and well, and I hope that you had a chance to go through our results documents. At the onset, we had the best quarter ever with a 53% revenue growth quarter-over-quarter and a 95% growth in adjusted profit after tax. Performance was very strong across both our business segments, which is the payments and the platform business, on the back of robust growth in our operating metrics. Our performance is particularly noteworthy given the macro environment and the recent pandemic. To our luck, India has done much better in terms of curbing the virus spread, contrary to the global expectations. However, the next 12 months will be defined by the timely availability of vaccinations across the country, as well as to the workforce to ensure mobility. Speaking about the overall performance, the budget was recently announced where there were certain specific indications on digital payment industry. The budget has earmarked 1,500 crores, approximately $200 million, for a scheme to incentivize digital payments, thereby giving a boost to the digital payments industry. There is a very clear focus by the government to set up a robust infrastructure for a boundless growth to happen in digital payments, and we welcome this move. Furthermore, the budget also announced an increase in the amount of capital expense for infrastructure and railways. We believe this could boost the procurements by these sectors on the GeM platform, which is provided by us, which significantly will allow several goods and services to be available on the platform. We believe that the economic stimulus package announced last year during the pandemic, coupled with the current growth-based budget announcements, can put the economy on fast track to achieve high single-digit to double-digit growth rates. This, along with the intention of the government to improve transparency through digitization to make India less cash economy, will significantly boost the digital transactions in this country. We, of course, have the benefit to be working in the digital payment space as we offer a full stack of digital solutions for businesses of all sizes. Furthermore, I'm also happy to inform you that NCLT has approved the demerger of our non-core businesses, and subsequently, the businesses will be listed on the stock exchange. The entities to be listed are Suvidha Infoserve Limited and DRC Systems Limited. We have allotted shares to the shareholders as per the record date. I'm also very happy to announce the bonus shares to all the shareholders. The board has approved to give one bonus share for every share held in the company. I would like to also intimate to you that we now will own majority stake in Soham Bharat. We've increased the stake in Soham to 50.5% from earlier 33%. As a reminder, Soham will be leading the license application to Reserve Bank of India along with consortium partners to set up pan-India new umbrella entity license, which is focused on retail payment systems. I will now hand over the call to Srikanth to give you business updates. Srikanth, all yours.
Thank you, Vishal. Thank you, investors. Thank you, participants, for your time. Let me start with the macro numbers. Our global revenues for this quarter actually stood at 228 crore, up 53% quarter on quarter. And our profit after tax, excluding share of associates, was about 15 crore, up 95% quarter on quarter. And our EBIT is about 23 crore, up 33% quarter on quarter. So this strong operating performance has led to, of course, strong business growth and revenue growth actually for the company. I will first like to highlight the performance of our payment gateway business, contributing bulk of our payment revenues and consolidated revenues. As you all know, we began our FY21 journey on a very strong note with a V-shaped recovery in payment gateway business. We achieved month-on-month growth since May 2020 after a fall actually in April due to nationwide lockdown on account of COVID-19 pandemic. However, by the end of Q1, that is by the end of June 2020, we had already surpassed our average daily payment processing compared to the pre-COVID level of March 2020 daily average. This outperformance was despite nil to negligible business from the four major sectors of our business, which is travel, tourism, aviation, hospitality, and entertainment industry business, which are some of our major contributors actually of our revenues in the past. Despite there were no business actually from these four sectors, we have actually grown immediately post-COVID level to the extent of significant number. In Q2 as well, these sectors were contributing far below the normal average, yet we crossed little over $1 billion on an average processing per month. Also in Q2, we registered about 150 plus new merchants daily from sectors like retail, education, grocery, IT, as well as we saw a greater interest from skilled professionals like doctors, lawyers, advisors, who seem to be building their business model online. Strong merchant registration, of course, continued in Q3, which is about 20% above Q2 daily average. We activated record number of merchants in Q3. Also, we activated about 5,000 merchants in just 3 days around the Christmas Day in December 2020. Of course, Q3 marked the highest amount of payment processing ever achieved by the company. We processed payments worth about 27,900 crores on an average, over 9,000 crores on an average on a monthly basis, compared to Q2 daily average of 7,500 crores. This corresponds to 23% jump quarter on quarter, 76% jump year on year. We are indeed excited. We exited December month at a rolling annual run rate of about 1,10,000 crore or about $15 billion on an annualized basis. Q3 being our festival quarter along with the holiday season in December contributed to sharp increase in payment processing. At the same time, improving economic and pandemic conditions in India with the receding lockdown restrictions led to increase in our consumption of various goods and services. Growth in Q3 was also contributed not only by our payment business, but also by our platform business. Among all the merchant customers and platform business, as you all know, government e-marketplace, one of our key clients, continued to grow quarter on quarter. This growth is especially due to our transaction-based revenue model arrangements with the customer. As the procurement value grows on government e-marketplace portal, our revenue will also grow, and so will be our bottom line. This is due to our SaaS-based business model, where revenue growth is non-linear to the growth in cost. We are not linked to any personal cost. The revenue growth is not linked to any services cost or personal cost and so on. It is typically non-linear to the growth in the cost. GEM, in the last 9 months ending December 2020, has already surpassed their GMV achieved for the full year of FY20. That is, they have already achieved 27,000 crores. This growth comes despite pandemic event. Government has committed to increase procurement from GEM based on the public reports and is ensuring increasing usage across various departments. Now, buyer organization on GEM portal has touched about 50,000, while number of sellers on the GEM portal has surpassed just about 1 million sellers. Again, it's all from the public reports. Government's intention to make it unified public procurement portal for all central and state government institutions in the country, as well as for railways, defense, and CPSEs, etc. And this will significantly add to the procurement on the GEM platform. A recent announcements in the budget towards CAPEX on infrastructures and railways will further increase procurement on GEM. GEM will also aim to bring about 20 to 30 million sellers across the country on its portal with a focus on SMEs and MSMEs, etc. Government plans to bring about 100 billion worth of procurement on GEM, and government, as you all know, spends around 250 to 300 billion annually on procurement. We mentioned in the last quarter that we have signed the definitive agreement with Reliance Industries owned Jio Platforms Limited and its affiliates to license, customize, and maintain and access Infibeam Avenue's enterprise e-commerce software and payment platform for their internal business use. This engagement is very strategic and is developing well, and currently integrations and testing are underway and it is going on in full swing. We will provide further updates at an appropriate time. That said, we are going to enable two of our four largest marketplaces in their journey to become India's largest marketplaces. Marketplace in India, whether small enterprise or large enterprise, are going through a certain amount of rough phases. But however, our profitability will grow and shall continue to grow as our business model is actually linked to deeper opening of further opportunities. Apart from these two customers, we also serve few other domestic and international clients and have other businesses under the platform business, which are complementary to our marketplace platform. We will continue to have such large customers and pursue such opportunities, not only in India, but also globally. We do not have any competition from any technology enabler to build and implement e-commerce platform of this large scale and such of this technological depth. Now, I will come back to the payment business, particularly on the bill payment business. Our bill payment platform offering BBPS services is seeing record growth quarter after quarter. And the numbers are very evident from our disclosure in the last few quarters. Our bill payments volume in Q3 has increased by 222% year-on-year and 31% quarter-on-quarter. We have 94% market share of the total 19,316 billers on BBPS platform as of December 20. We are a TSP to a majority of them. Total number of agents through whom we provide BBPS services has reached roughly around 650,000 across Pan India. And of course, there are more on the pipeline. We continue to add more billers. We have roughly 100% repeat business in this segment. We are seeing a greater traction building for Bill Avenue platform as more bill payment categories are being added on BBPS platform. Billers and agents are also facilitating bill payments through BBPS platform, and transaction volume on this platform is increasing month after month as per MPCI data. As tourism and travel, aviation, entertainments, and hotel industry keep opening up in the coming months, we believe we will further benefit as attraction on our REST Avenue platform will increase. REST Avenue is our hospitality platform built on CC Avenue platform payment gateway as an additional layer to specifically target hotels and resorts in the hospitality sector. We have over 3,000 plus hotels using REST Avenue platforms, including some of the marquee clients in India and UAE, namely Taj, Oberoi, ITC, Hilton, Carlton, Lemon Tree, etc. Moving on to our new business update, which are very crucial. And we have announced these new business updates in the last few quarters. And in FY21, we announced to launch many new fintech solutions under payment business, namely CPGS, CC Avenue Payment Gateway Services, B2B Payments, Express Settlement, Neo Banking, Digital Lending, Credit Card Issuance, on which I want to spend a few of minutes make you understand. It is important to note that these new business are based on our endeavor to improve not only on the top line, but also to boost our margins and increase cash flows in the company. Our endeavor is also to become an all-in-one payment solution provider, one-stop payment solution provider, and expand our breadth of portfolios to international markets in due course of time. This is one of our growth drivers in the company. At the same time, we also endeavor to offer our payments integrated with our marketplace platform to create enormous value to our customers. This will enable us to become one of our merchants' core e-commerce digital partner and meet most of their digital requirements under one roof. I want to spend a little bit of time on GPCH solution. With respect to our CC Avenue Payment Gateway solution, CPGS, we launched it first in Oman. CPGS is an on-premise SaaS model global payment solution to process cards of various payment networks like Visa, MasterCard, Amex, and more for financial institutions, etc. This service or fintech solution is always referred to as acquirer or processor services or solution. Until Q2, we offered these services to Bank of Dhofar, second largest bank by market value in Oman. We have now tied up with Oman's largest bank, Bank of Muscat. Together, these two banks have a majority market share of the card business in Oman. We have replaced two of the world's largest payment companies that were initially offering their services to these Omani banks. It is a very attractive business as it does not have pass-through as well as online transactions, and that comes to the bank or process buyer. Also, it is fully managed from India, and hence entire economics is very effective. We will scale this business globally. And these two accounts are considered to be our strong reference accounts going forward. And we will scale this business not only in India, but also globally. B2B payments is progressing very well. We onboard corporates directly as well as HDFC Bank has white labeled this solution from us, as you all know. We have many large market clients using these services for automation of bills receivables and bills payable. We are branded CC Avenue Finance, and under the CC Avenue Finance, one of the components is our Express Settlement. Express Settlement, where we lend or settle merchants' funds instantly. Instead of the regulated T plus 2 or T plus 3 operational since September 2020, we charge slightly higher rates for offering instant settlement services, which does not have any pass-through. Cost of funds for the company are currently practically nil, as we are using our own internal accruals for this arrangement. As you all know, we don't have any debts for working capital and so on. We are a net debt-free company as we speak. It improves our net take rates and also hence margins. We plan to scale this to 30% of India's daily GTVs over a period of 2 to 3 years' time. New banking, including lending and credit cards, are being tested internally and will be soft launched by the end of this quarter or early next fiscal. We will update the progress of this business at the appropriate time. GoPayments. GoPayments, one of our subsidiary companies in India, has now over 30,000 agents from 10,000 agents last year, resulting in a growth of 20,000 agents in a span of 1 year. Across 5,000 plus PIN codes in India, these agents assist customers with various services like domestic remittances, AEPS, BPPS, serve as cash collection center for corporates, offer recharges, etc. They collect cash from the consumers, but in turn convert cash to digital by making digital balance with us. These agents use our online platform for offering all the above mentioned services to consumers. GoPayment is at the run rate of handling little over $1 billion of cash annually, and it is growing month after month. They also have a transaction-based revenue model. That said, these new solutions, along with our existing business, will allow us to offer a comprehensive payment solution, NCAP passing, payment acquiring, which is our conventional business, payment issuance, which includes new banking, card issuance, and digital lending, three, domestic remittances and assisted commerce GoPayments, four, international remittances through one of our investee companies, Remit Online. Separately, SOHUM, our majority controlled subsidiary company, will apply to Reserve Bank of India for Pan India retail payment license along with our consortium partners. The final application date is 26th February 2021. This will significantly strengthen company's offering, payment offering, and will make us a truly global payment company offering retail payment solutions, including offering a global payment networks apart from India's RuPay. We will keep everyone posted with the updates, and this is one of our significant updates going forward if it results into action. As you must be aware, payment business along with our platform business is a winning combination. We call internally P plus P. P plus P is a very successful combination globally. Many software platform and technology companies are now adding payments to their business portfolio to drive growth. These companies command extremely rich valuations, despite some of them having a lower operating and profitability margin than us, while some of them are still lacking one. There are multiple companies in the US, internet giants in China, some in Japan, some in Asia Pacific. In our case, we have full stack of payment and platform solution with international presence and it's still growing year after year, quarter after quarter, month after month. In the last slide of my presentation, investor presentation, I had talked about actually our performance, robust performance, compared to some of the peers in the industry, both in India and also overseas. In the interest of time, I don't want to get into more details, but it is very self-explanatory. And should there be any questions on that, feel free to really reach out to us. Hence, we have higher operating margin and profitability margin compared to all the peers. And you can see from the last slide of our investor presentation that the investors will have significant amount of headroom considering our robust performance both in sales and also in margins. As I have mentioned earlier, we are a net debt-free company. We consistently convert EBITDA into free cash and have a cash conversion ratio of over 100%. And our CapEx is now behind us. We are a light asset model company, a non-linear to people, and revenues are transaction related, and revenues are transaction based models, both for payment business and also on our SaaS platform business. We continue to innovate and build further on our profit-centric business model and keep adding great business value for our customers, partners, and stakeholders. With this, I would like to hand over the call to Hiren Padia, who is our CFO, to discuss about our financial performance for this quarter under reference. Over to Hiren.
Thank you, Srikanth. Consolidated revenue, which has grown 53% quarter on quarter. So far as payment business is concerned, it has grew a very high double-digit percentage quarter on quarter, mainly due to 23% increase in payment and that to gross transaction value, that is 27,916 crores. Revenue also increased due to higher gross take rate, which increased by 33% quarter on quarter, as sectors like retail, grocery, IT, and also improvement in aviation and travel, and finally the usage of credit card, which has increased during the quarter. Platform business also grew during the quarter, mainly due to strong growth in GM and other businesses. Procurements on GM were highest ever in the quarter of around rupees 8,000 crore. Growth in bill payments, which is highest ever, that has all contributed to the growth in revenues. Bill payments volume, which has also increased to 6.4 million in quarter three. That is 31% sequential growth and 222 year-over-year growth. So far as EBIT is concerned, it has grown by 27% to rupees 22 crore, and adjusted PAT, which has improved by 95% to rupees 15 crore. Overall, Q3 ended on a very strong note. As we enter into Q4, we are very much hopeful to deliver a strong results. I now hand over the floor back to the operator for Q&A.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may please dial then one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press dial then two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Anyone who wishes to ask questions, please press star, then one. Participants to ask a question, please press star, then one. The first question is from the line of Nilesh Soni from ValueAd. Please go ahead. Nilesh from ValueAd, your line is unmuted. Please unmute the line from your side and go ahead.
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes, now you are. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for the opportunity, sir. I have a couple of questions. question. Sir, can you please share the more details on your Reliance deal? Like, what is the revenue potential from that agreement, and what would be the timeline or the period of the agreement which has been signed?
Yeah, I will take this question.
Yeah,
we signed the this is a very strategic contract from the company perspective. We signed the contract on 29th September. We announced it to the public on 30th September. And this is our licensing of our marketplace enterprise software platform to JPL and its affiliates for their internal business use. Fundamentally, that this will be a target platform for them for their internal business use. And contract permit us to do a lot more, value-added services as a part of this contract, which are significant in nature after the software actually put to use and put to target and put to go live and so on and so forth. Right now, the platform is actually, the software is under, test phase. And, the test results will be out actually. And after that, they will have their own process of going live and so on and so forth. Now, in terms of business model, it is basically, there are a lot of license fee model year after year. And there are success fee model linked to the transactions volume. And there is a facilitating model for our payment business through this target platform, primarily actually doing payment processing business for their GeoMart and other platforms and so on. Of course, we will also have an opportunity to do payment processing business for their telcos, a piece of their business. And we also support and maintain the entire Tiger platform once it is going live, actually. And that both the teams are working very hard, actually, to make it, go live. And it also has a training component. And it also has the customization component for customizing our existing marketplace software to suitable to the needs of the Jio platform. So all combining put together, the actions are, work is already started and it is going through a developing stage and also a testing phase stage and so on and so forth. There are models of licenses, there are models of revenues. And as and when the test phase is over and going live, all these revenues will get actually startup tree.
Okay. Any timeline or when it will be like going live for them? Means have they communicated something like that? Or
obviously, customer will ask the timeline yesterday.
Okay.
And it's a very huge target platform. It is not a small target. So therefore, we are working out in a very careful manner, and at the same time that it has to be a successful delivery and so on. So therefore, there's always a pull and push from the customers. We wanted to do it actually ASAP, but the time plan is also being worked out, and they keep changing the requirements and so on and so forth. So therefore, I'm not able to say very upfront about the timelines because it is also getting changed from the customer side actually.
Okay.
But as and when it is going live, definitely we will keep the investors updated.
Oh, okay, sure. Okay. And second question was regarding the Oman market. So are you targeting or approaching any other bank in Oman, means after this Dhofar and Muscat, or means any progress on finalization of a new client or something on that front in Oman?
As far as Oman is concerned, I think we are roughly with the humble submission is that Bank of Muscat and Bank of Dhofar is actually contributing 90-95% of the market share.
Okay.
So on this piece actually. So there are no other major banks actually left over in the country of Oman. However, with this woman being a strong reference, we would like to replicate the same success story in other parts of UAE and also in India as well.
Okay, that's it from my side. If I have any, I will be back. Thank you.
Thanks, Nilesh. Thanks.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, please press star, then one. Anyone who wishes to ask questions, please press star, then one. The next question is from the line of Deval Shah, an investor. Please go ahead.
Mr. Vishal, I'd like to ask that PayPal is exiting payment aggregator business from 1st April. Will it increase the business? My first question is this. And second question is, we are applying for that umbrella license. That for that 500 crore capital is required. So how we will cater to that capital?
Okay, sure. So, Vishwas, you want to take
PayPal? Yeah, I'll take it up. Yeah. Okay, so as far as PayPal quitting, it's their own internal call. They were not able to, primarily what we gather is that they were not able to compete with the existing Indian players that are there. That includes us, right? And they're going to still remain focused only on cross-border transactions. So from that perspective, it is one less competitor. So definitely, of course, the market is growing anyway. So if you look at the whole digital scape today, there's only 18% which is digitized right now. There's a whole lot of, almost 82% which still is the non-digital. So the headroom for us, for every player to grow is enough. And there are only 5 or 6 serious players. Including us. So I think there's a whole lot of opportunity in the coming years. Even transacting customers, only 110 million Indians are transacting digitally. The government's mission is to take it up to 500 million who will transact digitally. So that's as far as the overall scope and to grow. The second question was on the NUE. So the NUE right now at the stage of application, only 50 crores is required by the consortium of the main promoters that is there.
Yes.
Post that, 300 crore of positive net worth is required, right? An overall investment that is coming. So that is the post license. So right now, by Feb 26 is where we have to just demonstrate a 50 crore, which we can easily do between us and our very strong consortium partners who are coming in. And as you are aware, NUE licenses is like once in a lifetime opportunity. If you see the world's most valuable company, finance company is Visa, with a $500 billion market cap. And MasterCard is also at number 5 globally. It's more than JP Morgan Chase also, the valuation. So a network license like what Visa, Master, and PCI has is very valuable. And our company is making a very determined effort for it. So,
Yes Bank is your consortium partner? Because there was news floating around. Yes Bank is acquiring 10% stake in Soham.
Yes, the final one, as and when we finalize, we'll let you know. I think by Feb 25th, when the final licensing is done, we will do announce who the consortium partners are.
Okay. Fair enough. Thank you.
Participants, to ask a question, please press star, then one. Anyone who wishes to ask questions, please press star, then one. Participants who would like to ask questions, please press star, then one. The next question is from the line of Devesh Kumar from InCred. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon. Congratulations on a very good result. And my question is about the market. Should one be looking at your international side? Because domestic opportunities are so huge that one gets a sense that this itself will be the engine of growth or area where you can grow very fast? So one is how do you look at segments, domestic versus international? And in domestic, this first mover advantage, how far that will be effective on that, if you could make some comment. Thank you.
Okay, I will take it, Vishal.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so look, we are already two decades in the payments business, right? And the thing is that there's a all-round focus on our progress. So if you see, we are a global fintech company now. We're already present in India and in the Middle East, mainly in Oman, UAE, Saudi. We are already there in US now, and we continue to grow. So if you look segment-wise, while the platform business has always been in India and internationally, where we have deployed for earlier with many international brands, right? The payments business also is divided into multiple platforms. So one is the aggregator business that we do, where we acquire and own the direct merchant relationships. So in India, we already do it for the last two decades, have a million plus merchants and process a lakh crore amount of transactions every year at that run rate. Internationally also in UAE, we're doing significantly well. We are the number two players there, processing 3 billion dirhams worth of transactions every year and going fast with a lot of blue chip customers there. Saudi also, we've just started and we're making significant headway and will continue to grow. So CPGS product, as you said, is backward integration for us, where we offer the entire platform and the services to banks. And we have started off on a very good footnote in last two quarters with two banks in Oman, that is Bank Muscat and Bank Dhofar, also the G platforms in India who has used it. And of course, we will take it up. So there's a separate team who will take it internationally also. So the all-round idea is that we are going to be a global company and we are going to explore opportunities to the hilt, not only domestically, but also internationally.
Devesh, to add to what just Vishwas said, so you're right, the domestic market is huge for us. And given the 20 years that we have in this market, you know, and given the recent demonetization as well as the pandemic, that the take rate in the domestic market has gone through the roof. You know, fortunately, with experience and the risk management frameworks and many others that we've established and the very deep integrations with all the bank and the banking partners, we've got more than you know, a few thousand integrations, which are deep integrations that we've made. You know, adding, and we are adding more than 30,000 merchants every month. So that part has worked out pretty well for us. We don't think that we have to live in a world where we say that, you know, this competitive advantages of first mover will be there forever. So we are always innovating and we are providing, you know, more stickiness in terms of analytics and many dashboards and many other specific feature sets that most merchants require to be able to make it, you know, somewhat more sticky, and also work on the success rates and the success ratios, and analytics will play a big role going forward for us. To your point about international, you see, it opens up a very large opportunity for us, because if you target merchants who already are processing with us in India and open up in new geographies, and what Vishwas mentioned, which is that now we are there in at least four large geographies, that on a single integration for a merchant, they can be lighted up across multiple geographies. So if you look at, you know, very large MNCs, and, you know, the likes of Google's and the Facebooks and many others who have got presence in multiple countries, that a single integration with, you know, all common processes, systems, frameworks, established brand, that it opens up a very large opportunity for a set of customers that we typically only operate only for India, or potentially opens up for other geographies as well. So we think that digital will not have boundaries. We will continue building up our strong, you know, state-of-the-art framework for payments across multiple geographies. And, you know, we believe that the market in India for payments is highly evolved, whereas in other geographies, it is still in a very nascent stage compared to what India is. So this gives us a technology advantage to be able to get into those geographies and also be able to make a difference in those.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhishek Khanna from Jefferies. Please go ahead.
Hello. Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah, I am.
Hi, sir. I had one question which pertains to your revenue breakup, which is mentioned on the slide 4. So I just wanted to know right now, what is the breakup that you foresee for, let's say, FY21 between payments and platforms, and what is the breakup that you foresee, let's say, 2 or 3 years down the line? Because from what I understand, is it the case that you're moving away from a higher share of payments business towards a more share of the platforms business? That was my first question.
Okay.
Go ahead, Shrikant.
Yeah. Abhishek, I think we are experiencing roughly around 74% and 26% breakup towards payment business and platform business. And, you know, in terms of growth, I think we are seeing actually almost good growth in both of our two pieces. Namely, on payments also, we are seeing a significant growth, and also on platforms also. The platforms, we are seeing a growth because of this existing customers and also two very large strategic customers, namely GEM and GPL. And the model is actually transaction revenue model in any case. So over a period of time, I think in terms of CAGR growth, both the business vertical will grow. We believe that, you know, the range bound of 75% to 80% will be there actually between payments and, you know, the balance is actually market platform. Internally, we created a sort of, you know, competition that, you know, every business have to really grow. Every piece of business have to really grow. Even within payments, actually, we create a little bit of competition that every sub verticals actually within payment business have to really grow. So therefore, from that perspective, you know, the average trend which we have been seeing is 74-26. The trend is about 77-78 and so on and so forth going forward as well.
And that is the trend that you would want to continue with?
We want to continue. But the question is that, you know, it will happen by design because payment is a different...
There's no conscious effort to change it, per se.
I would say that because we would like to really have actually a range bound of... We are comfortable with 74-26 for a simple reason that platform business is extremely profit-centric. Because it's a non-linear business model. It is not like, unlike services companies, our cost is not, our revenues are not linked to cost of people and so on. It is a product organization, a typical SaaS-based model. So therefore, the profit-centric approach is going to be a heavy contributing factor actually from platform side of our business. And payment side of business is actually, as you know, it's extremely competitive. And there'll always be rate pressures and net take rate pressures and gross take rate pressures and so on. Therefore, we don't want to really lose any business opportunities in the context of our payment business. But I think overall, it's like a two horse actually in a vehicle. So both the horses will grow actually.
Got it. Thank you so much. One more question that I had was on the CGPS solution that you're offering in Oman. While I understand, so in a sense, Oman is a saturated market right now because you've acquired both the large institutions that you're mentioning there, and then you're saying that you plan to get into the same business in other countries as well. I just wanted to know, is there some sort of progress that you've already made in, let's say, India or any other country, and what is the potential that you see here, let's say, in India? And in addition to that, just if you could give some color on what is the revenue share of this particular product in your entire total revenue, CGPS specifically.
I will answer the second question, then I will leave the first question to be answered by my colleague, Vishwas. Second question is that, you know, the CPGS solution started about 2 quarters ago.
So it is in the in terms of revenue penetrations and revenue concentration, it is opportunities are very, very huge because banks being the customers actually in this particular piece. And therefore, since we just started two quarters ago, the revenue penetration as of now is relatively lower because it is now right now restricted to Oman country, but we would like to really replicate the same success in elsewhere as well, including India. So therefore, over a period of time, the CPGS is going to be a not only for the revenue, but also for the bottom line. So that is our strategy. So this is the new business offering in addition to our acquiring side of our business and so on. Regarding first question, I would like to hand over to Vishwas.
Is there a target probably that you would have in, let's say, 2 or 3 years, a percentage share of revenue that you would want from this before you move on to India about this?
Okay, look, CPGS, we are stepping into the domain of what FSS or Hitachi Payments or what MasterCard, MIGS or a CyberSource software does. It's like giving the entire payment gateway solution, either hosted or on-prem deployment for processing their transactions and their merchant network, right? So basically, any bank in the world who is into acquiring will need this software. So there are existing players that I mentioned, and we'll be competing against that. So we already started with Oman. We are already making inroads into some of the banks in UAE and Saudi Arabia. In India also, we have done the first deployment with Jio Platforms. We'll be using this enterprise payment platform of CPGS for processing their platform transactions. We also will be offering it to many other banks here in India as well as around the globe. So there's a whole unit set up to go across the Middle East, ASEAN, European Union, and others. So you'll see significant upscale in new client orders coming in on the CPGS product.
In addition to what Vishwas is saying, Abhishek, is that, you know, we have actually, you know, core banking integration with almost all Indian-based banks over here. And we have a relationship with almost all Indian-based banks over here. And this particular piece, you know, interestingly, we found out that the banks don't want to do this kind of a piece. They want to really, you know, get it done actually from players like us and so on. Therefore, you know, there is a greater degree of opportunity, and we have a platform and we have a solution, and it is working very well actually elsewhere. So why should we not replicate? I think the discussions are going on, and we are moving our coins very, very carefully. And, you know, we believe that this is going to be definitely one of our growth drivers actually going forward.
Just as a final follow-up, if I may. So you mentioned, and pardon my misunderstanding if it is, so this is a solution which is useful for, let's say, acquiring banks, right? One last question that I had in response to that is, not a lot of banks are very active in terms of acquiring right now. Probably that was the case maybe 5-7 years back, but now a lot of banks are not very active in terms of acquiring customers, the acquiring part of the payments business. So is it a possibility that the better market in India specifically might be not very huge for this particular product?
So let me put it in terms, let me put it in different terms. The acquiring banks that were there 5 years back were less than half a dozen. Today there are more than 1.5 to 2 dozen banks, around 18 to 20 banks who are acquiring transactions. And with the mushrooming of the small finance banks and all the different kind of banks that are there right now, most of them are getting into acquiring. Because one, they see a huge uptake. Second, they see it as a way of opening new bank accounts of SMEs and these things. So for them to offer, along with their bank accounts, also appoint processing services for their SME shops or MSME. So it's an all-inclusive solution, part of the overall filling of cross-selling different services along with their opening and keeping their current bank account. So you will see a lot many banks, and specifically the newer generation banks, who are getting into the acquiring piece.
Got it, got it. Thank you so much for your responses. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Hit Choksi from KR Choksi Shares and Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening. Congratulations, Vishal Bhai, Vishwas Bhai, Shrikant and Hiren Bhai for a stellar quarter. I had two questions. The first question is regarding the bonus issue which you have done recently. With the spree of acquisitions which you are planning to do, don't you think that you can utilize the amount in a better way rather than giving a bonus at this juncture? And my second question, which is a little bit more pertinent to the broader philosophy of acquisitions and investments. We have done significant investments in IGTL, which is GoPay, and the recent Soham Bharat, and erstwhile CardPay, which is into IGTL now. So can you just take us through, like, how do you see the convergence and integration of these various acquisitions into potential revenue opportunities and growth opportunities, and easier streamlining of payments across various merchants and categories?
Sure, Hit. So in terms of the second question, which is the investments that we've made in Go and many of the other companies, including CardPay, or now it's part of Go. You see, there are two different aspects of payments. If you think about abstraction, one is acquiring and second is issuance. And if you look at the history of the company, we have been focused on the acquiring piece, which is acquiring merchants for collecting payments on their behalf and remitting it into their accounts. Typical role of a payment aggregator. So basically, for any merchant, you want to be able to go and offer a service where they can accept payments, and that service we offer. Now, the second part, which is what you would hear about, is the issuance piece. And with the recent framework opening up for neo-banking and many others, you see, for companies that are supposing 10 different bank accounts and they want a consolidated statement and they typically don't need to go to the bank, and you can actually offer much better dashboard analytics and many others. For a company who has to make 50,000 transaction payments every day, you see, those things will now start coming up. And issuance is a very large space. Historically, it's been dominated by many of the card companies. Who work with banks, including banks, by the way. And the largest issuer maybe is HDFC Bank in India. But I'm sure that there are more and more companies who want to perhaps get into that space. If you think about card issuance, there's debit card and credit card, but there's also corporate cards. And so those opportunities, if you recollect, one of the things that we have done in terms of, I mean, typically issuance is lending. But one thing that we have done in lending, which we talked about a couple of quarters ago, is express settlement, where instead of doing T plus 2, T plus 3, T plus 7 settlement, that we do the settlement on the same day and we charge the merchant because the money is anyways in the escrow account. So, and I'll tell you that we do about 3 crores to 4 crores of settlement on a daily basis today, as of today. Which is that express settlement product itself, merchants are willing to pay, slightly more to get settled earlier. That completely improves their cash flow by 2 to 3 days. So as we get into that space, Go is our opportunity to get into the issuance part, if you will. And Go is already doing debit card issuance. And with Grit, they will also get into the corporate card and credit card issuance. And we think that there's a potential for that business to grow. It has to be a separate team and a separate company that focuses on it, because focus will drive success. And that is where, since Go is already doing $1 billion plus, of such businesses that, you know, they can continue taking on the credit part as well and keep on growing that portfolio. So if you think about neobanking, if you think about issuance, all of that will become part of our subsidiary, which is the GoPayment subsidiary, and now even CardPay as part of it. I think that, you know, we've been closely tracking a lot of companies that do lending in the SME and MSME space. And many of these companies, they do very well in the short term, but then in the long term, they already have certain issues that keep on coming up. With the data that we have, and more than a million businesses transacting through us, that we see some kind of a network effect that potentially comes in place, whereby for the companies who we acquire transaction for, or for the merchants that we acquire transaction for, the same merchants, we can also be working with them in terms of issuance, because we don't need their bank statements and we don't need a lot of information because we've got history of theirs for so many years. And so we see that there's some kind of a network effect that potentially plays out. It's too early to say, but through this express settlement, we will learn. Through Go payments and debit cards, we've learned more. And with, you know, grit and corporate cards, we will learn slightly more. So we don't expect that investments will play out immediately, but I think it's a very important aspect in terms of build up. And, you know, for a credit hungry country like India, there are many companies who want to work with Go in terms of offering their balance sheet to be able to lend to such corporate clients, and we'll be working with that first and eventually building up from there. So yeah, there will be some amount of investment cycle, and eventually we think that it's already actually doing very well. It's almost at a point where it'll break even. And you know, we expect that as we build up more, that potentially it becomes an opportunity for us to get into the second part of the seesaw, which is the issuance piece. So I think, I hope that answers that question in terms of, you know, our investments. We don't think there's an immediate return. It's a good medium to long-term investment. We've made that, and fortunately, we are at a point where we are almost breaking even in those businesses.
Yeah, I think the Go payments is clear, but how do you see the integration with Soham? I think that's what I was also keen to.
So Soham, So look, if you know the company philosophy, we are into payments and platforms. So platforms, we already know, we are doing on a mass scale. And as you see, there are going to be four marketplaces in the next decade fighting it out. So one is, of course, going to be Flipkart and Amazon. But two of the other parts will be totally powered. But in the sense, the heart of it will be ours. One is the GeM platform, the monopoly distinct from the government for acquisition, and other is going to be the geo platforms where we are going to make a significant contribution. On the payment side is divided into two, three parts, right? One is the acquiring part. The payments part is what we are doing in CC Avenue within Infibeam Avenues. So that goes from CPGS, that is the backward integration, right from the switch to the entire thing they're offering to the bank, to the front end that comes the CC Avenue part where we do the direct merchant acquisition aggregator business in various jurisdictions. So that's the entire payments piece and platform piece that we do in Infibeam Avenues. But then we require investments in multiple poles. So one, the investments are required in the ancillary fields around this platform that we do. So one is, of course, domestic remittance and assisted commerce, as well as lending and this thing. The other one is international remittances, where we need to have. So our investment in Remit Guru, Remit Online, that is there. Today, it is the platform that is built over there is used by 9 out of the top 10 banks in India. $9 billion worth of remittances flow through that platform. That's the international remittances. And once those become real-time, it can be an alternative to payment systems within CC Avenue. That's on the international remittances. For Go and Grit, that is there, as Vishal very clearly and easily explained, the entire issuance part and the lending part and the domestic, where we have presence across 25,000 agents, assisted agents, in around 600 cities and towns, is what we are doing through our investments in Go and Grit. So the entire lending piece, which is going to be a very important piece, is something that we are going to do within the Go Grit framework. The last piece comes is the network. Network is, as I told, it's like a master visa, this thing which works over everything else. Right. So it's like the scheme where all the banks become the members, and then through that comes the merchants. So these are the three philosophies that we have: the payment platform piece, the international and the domestic money transfer, as well as the lending and the grid part. So here, so if you understand, we are covering the entire payment landscape. Key part, we are doing it within the company, and others we are doing through our subsidiary companies.
Okay, yeah, that's helpful. That's a good clarity from both Vishal and Vishwas.
To just one more point on Soham. Soham is actually getting into the network part, which is what Vishwas mentioned. And it is, again, an application for license with consortium partners, which we are talking about, which we talked and covered. And that's where we see, an opportunity to actually utilize a lot of technology and infrastructure and framework that we have built out, and technically be able to create something which is of a scale of similar to an NPCI or a RuPay, and even more. To answer your first question around the bonus issuance, of course, it's a board decision. We see a lot of growth potential, in the next few quarters as we build out. And you will see quarter over quarter also that we've seen significant, rise in terms of our business, and processing volumes. For the first time, every month we have done more than $1 billion. That is a significant jump. We've been adding 30 to 40,000 merchants every month. That goes from merchants across all different types and ranges. So as we build up, and then we've got some large clients which we can't cover in terms of being able to work on very large infrastructure platform deployments like GEM, Geo platforms, and many others, that as we see that growth and that potential, that bonus was considered by the board as an option to be able to build up as we go forward.
Understand. That's very helpful. Just one clarity which I would like to understand. Since the Soham is now like an acquisition and it will be a subsidiary in the future, you said that there are going to be potential partners in Soham, which will be announced soon in February. So I have one I just want to get some understanding as to how will the data sharing happen, considering that it will be your subsidiary. And will this data will also be available to the other affiliates who will be a part, or you will use this data for your own mining purpose and revenue generation ability?
So I think the way to think about this is that, and you've touched a very important topic, because it's the need of the hour in terms of data sharing. And, it's not just us, but it also has a repercussion to the likes of Facebook and Google and many others. Okay. So I think there's a lot of interpretation around it. At this point, we are just focused on the build out of the business first. And not necessarily about, we're not worried about the data sharing part. The first part of Soham would be to actually get the license and then apply for it with the partners and be able to build the pieces together. But that's a very important question, something that we have the right people actually thinking about it to be able to guide us as we...
I asked this question, because since you are very, very bullish on the payment space, and which is your USP, considering your cash or cash generation ability, I was thinking whether you would actually be able to acquire the entire company and not go for partners, which would give you a much better...
That is not possible, because RBI has mandated that it's distributed ownership, and a single company cannot own the entire setup. So I think that regulatory-wise, it's been covered.
Okay.
It's not sufficient for things to make.
Fine. Thank you for the understanding, and all the very best for a very, very good year.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question. I now hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Thank you all for joining our call, and thank you for being an investor. And we look forward to keeping you updated in the progress of the company.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of KR Choksi Research, that concludes this conference. We thank you all for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.